here on late again. Good afternoon and welcome to the qualifying session for the third round of the 2012 GT3 European Championship. We're here in Navarra, Spain for this qualifying session, which will be split into two 20-minute segments. My name is Jack Nichols. Alongside me here in the commentary box is John Watson. John, it's a pretty warm day, but around this time yesterday we had a pretty severe storm. It doesn't look like we're going to get that kind of thing today, although there are a few dark clouds here and there.
Well, the temperatures are dropping. It's now only 26.4, which is a drop of about 5, and track temperature is down to 38, which is a similar amount. So the air temperature is dropping, no doubt, due to that wonderful piece of sculpture in the sky called a cloud.
So we've got a 20-minute session for Q1. This will decide the grid for the first race, and then another 20-minute session where the second driver will take over, and that session will set the grid for the second race. Interestingly, this weekend, both of the races are going to be on the same day. So the qualifying session is taking place now, but both of the races will be tomorrow, whereas usually they're split over the Saturday and the Sunday. There is the 15 car that is being started by Jerome Demay in this qualifying session. He and Dino Lenardi lining up, and they are 7th place in the championship. At the moment then, a few of the cars to watch out for. Championship leaders out there are Gaetano Ardangna Perez and Giuseppe Ciro. They are in the number 50 red AF Corsa car. Second place in the championship is Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch. They're in some silver Heiko Gravity Giroux cars, and then the 51 AF Corsa car of Michael Lyons and Stefano Guy are third placed in the championship. So we'll keep you up to date with all of that. We're currently watching the 11 car of David Mengsdorf. He made his debut last time in Zolder. He and Harry Prochick took 2 second places in both races in Zolder, so they're up in 5th place in the championship. And the Lamborghini, as we've seen in GT1, as we've seen in the past few years, is a strong car. Finally, just to cross the I's, dot the T's, here's a new entrant for this weekend, the 32 Belgian Audi Club Team WRT, fielding Yves Verts and Kurt Mollekens, 2 Belgian drivers in the 32 Audi.
And in fact, it was an Audi that was quickest in free practice. Jerome Dumais and Dino Lenardi splitting his time between GT3 and GT1 this weekend, and they did a 1:40.3. Strong run in GT3 for the Audi. They weren't quite so strong we saw in GT1 qualifying, but nevertheless the Audi R8 V10 is a force to be reckoned with in FIA GT3.
Indeed. So there you can see the Audi coming through turn 3, through the left-hand kink at 4. Of course, the Belgian Audi squad performing very strongly in GT3 last year, and they decided to move their attention to FIA GT1 this season, and obviously started the season with fantastic success. We're also, of course, the Blancpain Endurance Series champions in a GT3 spec car, so very rich heritage in a very short team career compared to some of the others, the likes of AF Corsa, for example. But it's a 29.0 in Sector 1 for the Audi R8. Not a particularly stunning first sector, but it's not too bad. The fastest we've had is a 26.7, so yeah, just starting to get into the swing of things at the moment is Yves Verts. You can see the black clouds actually behind that hill.
I mean, if this was to turn into a wet qualifying session, which I don't think it will do, but it may well turn wet for qualifying of the GT1 qualifying event. The driver who I reckon would be a real star, it's not in GT1, it's in GT3, is Michael Lyons, who came just recently, 2 weekends ago, from a thoroughly wet Monaco historic Grand Prix, where he won in a Hesketh F1 in the post-78, I think it was, or post-75, but non-ground effect, drum brakes, you know, and wire throttles and all that sort of stuff. So Michael Lyons, thoroughly familiar with saturated racetrack conditions.
So to the top of the timing screens goes the goes David Mengsdorf, actually, that 11 Lamborghini. So not quite exactly what the graphics were showing there. It's the 11 Lamborghini that has gone to the top of the timing screens. Yeah, Michael Lyons will be used to driving in the rain as well, having plied his trade in the British GT Championship for the past couple of seasons. And when it rains here at Navarra, I mean, it properly rains. Did you get caught up in the thunderstorm last night? I was running around the paddock and almost lost it in my slick shod shoes. So it really, really comes down when it rains here.
I didn't make any reference to the comment you made because I had disappeared off back to my hotel and there was nothing happening 30 kilometres down the road in Pamplona, and I wasn't even aware that you had a thunderstorm at the racetrack.
Yeah, no, it absolutely bucketed it down for a good couple of hours. So still lapping quickly is David Mengsdorf. Maybe important to get this running done as quickly as possible. 26.5 in the first sector, best of anyone so far, so he is really looking like he's hooked it up.
And in fact, he's picked up a tenth of a second because he had the previous best at 26.6, so this is a strong run from David Mengsdorf in the Lamborghini, and that's the Rhino's Lifeboat Motorsport car, two of them in the race. So they are looking comfortable at the minute. Got the best part of 9/10 of a second advantage over the second place there. Of course, Ferrari, Gallo Ardengo Perez said as best I can. The Venezuelan driver who was overdid it, his delight at winning in Zolder was just palpable.
Across the line comes the 15 car of Jerome Demey. Is he going to improve this time around? He's done some personal bests in there, and it's a 42.2 for Jerome Demey, so 2 seconds off Mengsdorf's pace at the moment. So at the moment, David Mengsdorf has a 1.8 second advantage at the front of the field, which is pretty impressive. There we can see 14, which is Ni Amarim. He's yet to take to the circuit. We've only seen 6 of the cars so far. We've seen neither of the Heiko Gravity Shiru cars until now, because coming out of the pit lane is the number one car, which will be started by Dominic Baumann, and he will hand over to Maximilian Buch. One more final piece of housekeeping. That's the number 4 Russian Bear Motorsports car, Miguel Torrell and Sergei Ryabov. In free practice, its sister car, the number 5 Russian Bear, lost it at that final corner, went heavily into the wall, destroyed the front end, and unfortunately we will not see Vyacheslav Maliev or Kirill Ladygin out racing this weekend. But that Ferrari goes second. Pretty good performance from them. We haven't seen the Russian Bear guys perform particularly as strongly as they would have liked. Best position was for Maiv and Kate Ladygin last time out in Zolder, which they had a fourth position, which was mainly due to the weather conditions, really. But the Ferrari's looking a bit better this weekend.
Yeah, and I think many people here think that the Ferrari, in particularly GT3 form, might just be the right car for the right conditions at the right racetrack. As we look at the sister car, 51, Stefano Gaia and Michael Lyons, who we were just relating to a moment or two ago. Michael Lyons having that success in the historic Grand Prix at Monaco. And so Stefano Gaia and Michael Lyons are strong. They did test here, I mentioned, a little bit earlier in the season. And in fact, it was Michael Lyons who alluded to me on the way out on the flight that they had slight concerns about how brake would stand up to the rigours of this circuit. So we will find out probably relatively shortly whether the brakes on a Ferrari or the brakes on everybody in general are going to be man enough to deal with this Navarro circuit.
So Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch, reigning champions with, Heiko Gravity Shiru's are the reigning champions, currently second place in both the team and the driver standings. They come across the line to go seventh, but of course that's their first real flying lap in any kind of anger. And as they fly into turns 1, 2 and 3, a corner where we saw the Mercedes struggling in GT1, but there are no such dramas in GT3.
Well, it'll be interesting to see whether the GT3 Mercedes-Benz SLS suffer the same way that the other Inkel cars of Marcus Winkelhock and, of course, the sister car of Nicky Pastorelli. They both really struggled massively into turn 2, particularly under brakes at the point where they're turning and the cars are throttle. And there's no reason why there should be a huge amount of difference between the two cars. Certainly in terms of aerodynamics, you can't imagine there's a huge amount of difference.
No, so it's a 26.8 in this first sector. That's 0.3 seconds slower than David Mensdorf's first sector, which, well, if he kept up losing 0.3 each particular sector, he'd end up second on the grid provisionally, so there's a lot to be said. There comes the... And he's still 36.2. He's still only 0.3 seconds down, actually, so this is going to certainly, I would suggest, launch him up onto the front row of the grid.
Yes, it looks like a potential front row sitting for the Mercedes-Benz. Comes out at turn 13. There's the riders, the entry into the pit lane. And then this flat-out flick through to the left and then on the brakes to the final turn, turn 15. Just get the car in gently, get the nose pointing towards the straight and then get on the throttle. So it's going to be a reasonable effort from the Mercedes to come across the line. And it goes second.
Yep, second place, 40.311. So most of the time being lost in the first sector. 0.3 in the first sector, nothing really in the middle sector, and maybe 0.1 in the final sector, clouding the curves, wasn't he?
Well, not just that, it just looks a lot more stable than the GT1 version of the Al Enkel car.
Maybe Al Enkel need to pop down and have a little chat.
I suspect there are a few more subtle differences, because how one team might approach a particular circuit. They may make a sacrifice on one corner to gain performance around the rest of the circuit. But certainly looking at those Happy Gravity Cherouz team Mercedes SLS, looking much more stable than we saw on the Al Enkel cars.
There is the 50 car then. Our current championship leaders, Gaetano Ardangna Perez, is at the wheel of that one before Stefano Guy takes the second session. 8 minutes to go here, and he's just turning into corner 13. He's coming straight back in. He has set a lap time of 41.5, so still 1.7 seconds off the pace.
Ardangna Perez, like his fellow Venezuelan Pastor Maldonado, you would never really thought that a country like Venezuela would have produced international quality drivers, and Ardangna Perez did a very good job in Zolder. We know what Pastor Maldonado has done in Spain some 2 weekends ago. As we go back to the Ferrari, flicking through into Stefano Guy, coming through turns 2 into turn 3, and again the car looks comfortable, it looks stable, it gives the driver confidence. Again, the cloud just hanging over the exit of turn 4 in this middle of the circuit that winds its way, a very long turn 5 which flows into turn 6, again showing the confidence in the Ferrari, being able to run right out to the edge of the curb. A driver who doesn't go out that far normally is feeling that the car is going to get away from him, so it will automatically take the car nearer to the middle of the track. And we just saw there from Ardangna Perez and Stefano Guy.
It's one of those corners that it's one of those corners, if you stay really wide, you can feel like if you're on the brakes, you feel like you're never actually going to get in to that left-hand apex.
So you put a premium on the front end of the car.
Yeah.
Because if you hang out and hang out and hang out at the point where then you want to make the nose turn to make the apex of turn 7, you've got to have a very good front end on that car. And if it's prone to washing out, well, if you take that very wide line up to turn 7, you might as well hang the washing out, because it's just never going to get anywhere near the apex of the corner.
So, up into third position has just jumped Max Nielsen. Third place for him then in the number 2 Mercedes. What can Michael Lyons do? He exits the final corner, currently 10th and last, but this will soon pick up a little bit. He comes across the line. It's going to be a 1 minute 40 point something, 0.7. So that puts him up into fourth place. Not a bad lap at all. 6 minutes to go though, so there's still plenty to change. No one has been able to catch David Mengsdorf as yet. He has a 0.4 second advantage ahead of this man, Dominic Baumann, at the head of the field. This has been a mild middle sector and a decent first sector. So across the line he comes. Does he improve his time?
Yes, he does.
But
not position.
No, not really enough time to make too much difference.
Look, you can see, watch this car under braking. It just inherently looks like it's got a better balance. It's got better grip than those that maybe didn't get to watch GT1 qualifying, but the GT3 version of the SLS, I mean, lapping slower than the GT1 version is doing in fairness, nonetheless, more confidence being offered up to the driver than we were seeing for the Al Enkel entered GT1 Mercedes SLS.
So what can Max Nilsson do on this lap? He's done a personal best in Sector 1, a pretty poor Sector 2 actually, 7/10 of a second off the pace. So he may well just try and take a nice wide line through the final corner and get as much straight line speed as possible down the start finish straight. I don't think that Max Nilsson is going to make an improvement this time around. He's currently on a 40.6. He comes across the line to do a 40.8, so 8.32, so no improvement that time. He's just got to hope that, I think it's Niamarim up in front of him on the road, the Portuguese driver in the Portuguese team, can sort things out as we get the cool look. Those helmets always remind me of something from Star Wars. I'm pretty sure that the people who operate the Death Star's big gun have helmets very similar to that. But anyway, there's the 32 car coming across the line of Yves Wurts, and that is still 10th position in that Audi R8. A couple of seconds off the pace at the moment for that new team to GT3 this season. David Mengsdorf still in the pits, actually. He's only done a couple of seven laps and has then come back into the pit lane, so yeah, I can still see him sitting in there along with one of the Ferraris, so he's obviously pretty confident that that time is, you know, well, as good as he's going to go.
He's got the best part of 4/10 of a second advantage over Bauman in the Mercedes, so unless the Mercedes goes out and suddenly laps very much more quickly, if you do your job and get it done, why go out and run the tyres, run the brakes, run the car? If you've got a well-balanced car, which would appear to me to be the case with the Lamborghini number 11, then just sit it out. There's no need to be on track. We've only got 3 minutes of the session or so remaining, so the time it would take to get out, do a flying lap and take the checkered flag, well, he did the job very early in this session, and no one's really come close enough to challenge.
So we've only got 3 minutes to go in this session that has really flown by. Mengsdorf currently the quickest, as we say, 4/10 of a second ahead of Dominic Baumann, who is another 4/10 of a second ahead of his teammate Max Nilsson, who didn't improve on that last lap. Is anyone lighting up the timing screens at the moment? No, they're not. We've got a personal best in that final sector for Michael Lyons, which has brought him down. Well, it hasn't improved his time, though. It's just a personal best in the final sector, so he might be winding one up. There is the pit lane alarm that you can hear, which is to let them know that a team is coming into the pits, and that car is Dominic Baumann. There in the pits is Gaetano Adana Perez. He's happy with his work, because unless they go out right now and nail it, they're going to be, oh, that's very, very wide for Michael Lyons.
Yeah, I mean, you
took it quick, though. Quickest first sector he's done.
Yeah, but I mean, there's a point at which there's diminishing returns, and if you get so far out so late on the approach up to turn seven, then maybe you're not going to gain anything at all. But that's all a part of just, you know, individual preferences and what the car lets you do. Michael, you can see hard on the brakes coming down into turn nine. You can see with the car squatting in the nose as he nailed the carbon brakes on the Ferrari 458 Italia.
Now this is going to tell us how he's done in the second sector. 37-0, so that's not gone particularly well for him in the middle sector. He's already 9/10 off, which is, well, if he loses no, if he makes up a couple of tenths, if he finds a tenth of a second in the final sector, he could jump up into third place, but that's about it as far as this lap is concerned. He will get one more out of it, but our top three are all in the pits. It's only really Michael Lyons that can do something about changing the order in the top five. Across the line he comes then. Is this going to be an improvement for Michael Lyons? 1 minute to go. He starts his final lap of the session. He does a 41.2. It's no improvement, so it's now or never for Lyons if he wants to get out of that fourth place. Across the line comes Wurts, and it's no improvement there either. So here is Jerome, or is this Mark Sword? We haven't seen anything of Mark Sword.
Mark Sword,
have we, yeah?
According to timing and scoring, we've not really seen much of him at all. He's down in ninth position, uncharacteristically out of the front row or two, three rows of the grid in the Audi R8 V10. So comes across start finish line, gets to do another lap, and does a 142.2. And that is his best, but it's, again, it's still way, way from the races and into a little bit less aggressive coming up through turn one on the brakes, down the gears into turn two, then exiting out of turn three. Track temperature's risen slightly, ambient's risen slightly, so that big black cloud that was going to threaten has maybe now moved elsewhere, and things are beginning to warm up marginally.
Yep, quite possibly. So there is Niamarim, the Portuguese driver in the Portuguese Team Nova driver, and he is going to come across the line. He's done his personal best in sector two. How far is he off Jerome de May in front? He could squeeze up possibly into seventh place here, Niamarim. Across the line he comes, currently in eighth. Can he make it up to seventh place and dispense of the second Audi? No, he cannot. He does a 41.875, his personal best of the session so far, but not enough to move him up any positions. Michael Lyons has done a poor first sector, one and two. He comes across the line, there he is, and does not improve. So, oh, we've got one more to come. Here comes Wirtz across the line. And, oh, we've also got Mark Sword to come as well. But none of them are really setting the lap times alight at the moment. As Sword comes into the final corner.
So we're nothing saying anything special on those individual sectors, sector one and two. No improvement, no personal best. So disappointment for Mark Sword and, you know, the Belgian, oh, sorry, the Santaloc Racing RD team. And they're going to be starting well down. This particular car is anyway down on the fifth row of the grid. Certainly from this position, with a ninth place position on the grid.
So, well, we're about to have a spin or something for Jerome de May, are we? Is he going to go, oh, here we go, up to this troublesome corner. There goes the back end. You can see all the tire marks. So many people have spun there because you're turning in, you're braking, you're coming off the throttle all at the same time. And it can prove a real challenge. But David Mengsdorf it is, who will take pole position for the first race of the day tomorrow. Dominic Baumann will start second on the grid. Max Nilsson in third. Michael Lyons, good effort from him. Fourth place for the car of the first F Corsa car, in fact. Then we've got, well, we've got Ferrari 4, 5 and 6. Miguel Toril starting in fifth place. Sixth place for Gaetano Aldana Perez. Seventh will be Jerome de May in his Santaloc Racing Audi. Eighth position for Niamarim, and I wonder if that Audi hasn't seen the checkered flag, perhaps.
Well, I'll tell you what, he'll know about it if he hasn't seen it, because that'll be straight into the stewards, and they'll get a fine of some description, whether it's a fiscal fine or whether it'll be a penalty. But certainly it's pretty much inexcusable not to have seen the checkered flag. It's fundamental. And he's still continuing with undiminished speed.
Still going for it, isn't he? So the little man who waves the checkered flag gave him a little.
Oh, what's going on? What's going on?
Get past that.
So exactly.
No.
He's in.
Work
I think. I think you might say
Burt's.
He's in the zone.
Yeah, exactly. Let's hear from David Mengsdorf. Very confident, very fast with Haley.
David, with that lap time, you must be confident you're going to get a good result in the race.
Yeah, we hope so. We are now in P1, so we hope we can make tomorrow the same job. Now we look to Harry. I think, yeah, he's able to make P1 as well. And yeah, we hope so that we have tomorrow a good race.
Thank you.
So, David Mengsdorf on pole position. And, well, that Lamborghini, as we said, there's only one Rhino's Leiper Lamborghini out this weekend, unfortunately. But there's a great sense of anticipation coming up before the second qualifying session, because the different drivers will have different kind of performance levels, and we could well see, well, we saw it in Zolder, a completely different grid second time around because of the different levels of performance in the driver. Are we going to go to pit this time from Yves Wirtz? Yes, we are. So they might have to have a little chat to the clerk of the course.
I think there'll be
like
a visit to race control.
Yeah.
And I mean, obviously, clearly, it was not the driver's fault. In those circumstances, the driver didn't see the flag. In fact, the flag wasn't out when he came past.
No,
and,
yeah,
you know, most drivers will walk into a race control to get a strip torn off him, believing that he never saw the flag.
Yeah.
Strange, that, isn't it?
Yeah.
Funny things, racing drivers. Funny
Here's
people.
A look at the results. You can see Audi R8 struggling a little bit, aren't they? 7th, 8th, 9th and 10th David Mengsdorf will start on pole position for the race tomorrow. Dominic Baumann alongside him on the front row. Max Nielsen in third. Then the three Ferraris, fourth, fifth and sixth. Michael Lyons, Miguel Toril, and then Gaetano Ardangna Perez. And then, as we say, the Science Lock Racing Audi of Jerome Demay in seventh place. Nova driver of Niamarim. And then the Science Lock Racing car of Mark Sword in ninth. Before 10th place, Yves Vets. Well, they may get a grid drop for ignoring the checkered flag, but that may not affect them because they will be starting in 10th place anyway. So we're going to have the second qualifying session in a few moments' time. The team's just changing over drivers, and they'll be able to pass on some valuable information, I think, the first drivers, because conditions will be a little bit different to the practice session.
Yeah, but I think the thing is interesting, all the Audi drivers ran their bronze drivers, you know, they might loosely describe them as their gentleman drivers in this qualifying segment. Now, with the second qualifying coming up, you've got Dino Lenardi in the Jerome Dumais car, you've got Jonathan Hershey in an Audi for the first time in the Mark Seward car, and you've got Kurt Mulliken's in the Yves Vets car. So expect actually to see those three Audis, forgetting the Amarone car, but never Campanicho, may well also do a good job. So I would imagine we're going to see the Audis mixing and matching much more in this qualifying segment coming up than we did during the one we've just watched.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's fair to say. Cesar Campanico will be taking over from Niamarim in that Nova driver car. And as you say, Dino Lenardi will be one to watch. ADAC GT Masters champion last year. He's already been out on this circuit.
The one to watch for me is Jonathan Hershey.
Yeah.
More familiar in a Mercedes SLS than in an Audi R8, or certainly to me. And we'll be curious to see how he gets on.
Yeah, it's his debut in FIA GT3 this weekend. There is the car that Cesar Campanico is about to qualify, probably about 2 or 3 minutes before this session gets underway. There you can see Campanico on the left, Niamarim on the right.
He's got a bit of a gut on him, hasn't he? I mean, he's not exactly sort of the two built, trimmed down, svelte racing driver that you expect to see in professional motor racing.
The two Portuguese drivers in the Portuguese team.
Too much good seafood.
Yeah, well, exactly. That's always a problem with Portugal, isn't it? There you can see beautiful Spanish surroundings here. A couple of fans milling around. We're obviously, the main event is tomorrow, the championship race. Hopefully we'll get a few guys coming down later on as well for the GT1 qualifying race. But tomorrow really is the big day. It was a decent crowd that turned up last year.
I mean, super crowd.
Yeah, heavily promoted. We had a demonstration of GT cars in the square in Pamplona on Wednesday, I think it was, and that drew quite a crowd as well. So,
and the interesting thing, the only bulls in the square were Lamborghinis.
Yep, exactly.
Not the charging ones that you get for that mad Pamplona weekend when the bulls are let loose in the town.
We should come back for that. Would you be up for doing that? Running away from a bull?
Oh, too old for all that stuff.
So in the day you would have done. Back in the day. There you can see the crowd watching on. It's decent viewing around here as well, actually. There's some really nice big banks that you can lay on in the beautiful Spanish sun and watch some excellent GT racing. And there you can see the pit lane and all the hospitality above it, and then the VIP section on the roof.
I mean, it really is a super facility here in Navarra. I mean, it's a provincial racetrack. It's in a part of Spain where motor racing would not normally be something you would imagine to see, but they've planned it, they've executed it really, really successfully. Circuit's long enough to make it interesting. It's 3.9 kilometres, 2.4 miles, 15 turns. Very good. Good effort.
Let's hear from Vincent Voss. He's down in with Hayley. He's the boss of Audi RRT.
Vincent, how do you feel the Audi R8 is performing in GT3?
Well, it is a tough race for a tough track for the Audi, but well, so far I would say Yves is quite happy about what they have achieved. Well, he is just here to learn about the championship, about the track, and it is only his second race weekend. His first was last weekend, so a lot of things to learn.
That's quite an achievement. The driver did stay out in the last session, an extra lap. Was he aware that he needed to come in, or did he miss the flag?
Yeah, he just missed the flag, and he did not understand on the radio. it is just a driver mistake, but he has to learn.
Thank you very much.
So, Eve in his second weekend of motorsport. Good effort. It's a lot to learn in a very short space of time.
Well, I don't know whether it's the second weekend ever, but certainly second weekend of this year. And but part of what you've got to do as a racing driver is take on board all the elements that go on around you, and it is pretty basic that when you come onto the start-finish straight and you're in contact with the team, it's available by a visual prompt with a pit board or by a radio communication. And to not see the checkered flag is, okay, maybe he was looking down at the dash or, fiddling with a cigarette lighter or something. I don't know what he was doing, but it does happen. It happens at even higher levels than we are here right now.
Well, I remember being at a Brands Hatch historic race a couple of years ago, and Jackie Oliver missed his drive-through penalty board for about a one-hour race.
Story of his life.
Yeah. it can happen to anyone. There you can see that Kurt Mollekens will be about to take over in that WRT Audi R8. We saw the Audis struggling then in the first qualifying session. What can Jonathan Hershey do at the wheel of his Audi? Expecting some decent things from him, I think.
Yes, I would expect to see a strong performance from Jonathan Hershey. They're more familiar with an SLS Mercedes-Benz than the Audi R8 V10, but a good driver can adapt extremely quickly to the different layout configuration. This, of course, mid-engine V10 as opposed to the front engine, but effectively mid-engine V8 of the Mercedes.
So he's just getting some heat in the tyres as he weaves down the back straight and then into the braking zone for turn 9 down there at the end, and that's somewhere where we'll expect to see a reasonable amount of overtaking. Of course, Jonathan Hershey has competed in FIA GT1 as well, has entered 13 rounds, in fact, of FIA GT1, including a couple, the last two of last season at Beijing, and what was the last one? Argentina, wasn't it? San Luis, Argentina, alongside.
Well, regrettably, I wasn't there.
No, nor was I.
They had wonderful place.
Yeah, I'd love
a wonderful racetrack.
But they chose the two others for that gig, didn't they? Jonathan Hershey out, and he's going to come across the line now to start his first true flying lap. He's still going to be trying to get the tyres up to a little bit of temperature. That's a 159 because he's just come out of the pit lane. So this is where we'll get a mildly representative time. Again, sounded like he was flat, or was
I talking? I mean, every car, GT1, GT3, flat through turn one is not a problem. It's when you take your pure road car like the Mercedes SLS that is here this weekend, along with other Mercedes product to act as track cars, medical safety and lead car. Doing it in a pure road car configuration is an entirely different prospect to an out-and-out race version of the same car. In the downforce levels, the grip levels, the braking capacity are of a magnitude that the owner of the road-going version couldn't even imagine. And that's what motor racing does. It develops and improves the brand.
Yeah, absolutely. And this Audi R8 LMS comes down into the braking zone, and Hershey getting the job done down there at turn 9. A decent first sector, 26.6. Not too bad at all, I think. I can't remember. It's kind of low 26.
It's low 26, yeah. 26.6 is in the ballpark of a middle 1 minute 40, late 41 second lap.
And I would say this is the kind of lap time we're about to see from Jonathan Hershey, somewhere in the late 40s, low 41s, and I think that would be a pretty decent first flying lap, actually, because it was a very, very quick time for the first qualifying session. But of course, as we say, we've probably got some of the quicker drivers out in this second segment, so headlight flashing a little bit as he comes across the line. It's going to be a 1 minute 40.5.
Very good effort.
Very
good run.
Very good final sector as well. So that's a real benchmark to beat already, isn't it?
Well, I think that's sort of set the performance. This is the benchmark that you're going to have to improve upon. And Jonathan Hershey has certainly given the Audi a better run than the previous four drivers that were in the Audis in first qualifying for GT3.
Yep.
Watch this car as well. This is without doubt, this will be Kurt Mullikens, another driver, extremely experienced, very quick, capable of taking a very good time out of that car. Now, he's not managed to improve upon the personal best in those first two sections, overall best, but he's got personal best on his first flying lap. So let's see what Kurt Mulligan, with all his experience, is going to give this Belgian ID race team.
Yep, so...
Unsurprisingly, goes second quickest. And, well, in fact, the time is a 1:54, it's 14 seconds away, so it's irrelevant. So we'll see now. Oh, and a bit of a slide coming through turn two, gets it all gathered up into turn three, neat and tidy, and now flat out through turn four, and the drop down. You can see the way the racetrack falls away, and you pick up speed into turn five.
Yep, Kurt Mullikens then. Obviously a very quick driver in his own right. Started off karting in 1990. Here you're going to see that slide again.
He took a lot of the curb on the inside, which may have caused that back end. But he gathered it up nicely, and he just about... Well, he missed the apex, but he certainly did a good job in the recovery of what would have been, in maybe lesser hands, a bigger moment.
Yeah, so Mullikens now down into the hairpin. The ex-British Formula 3 racer won the international Formula 3 race at Zandvoort back in 1996, so...
Doesn't get any better than that.
It doesn't, does it?
I mean, that's the equivalent of winning the Monaco Grand Prix in Formula 3 terms.
Exactly, so a driver with plenty of pedigree, and he now comes into the right-hander at turn 13, the hairpin, and he's done personal best in sectors 1 and 2. It's obviously that car pretty late into the championship this year, well, round 3, but, you know, we're approaching the halfway stage in the championship, so they're going to have trouble matching those that have been in there since the start and the rate of development that they've managed to pull off. But WRT, pretty strong team, and I think this will be a 41 something, I would suggest, maybe even a 42.7. So across the line he comes, and he'll be looking to find some more pace than that. Jonathan Hershey has done purple in sector 1, he's gone purple in sector 2. There you can see him coming into the right-hander at turn 13. We've still only seen 4, 5, 6, 7 cars, so there's a couple still in the pits. The two Heiko Gravity Charouz cars yet to go out, but this is looking a good lap.
What's interesting, listening to Jonathan Hershey, listen to how he gets the power on. It's not a slam, it's just a very nice picking up of the throttle, getting it open, and then driving the car off the corner. Can he improve on that 40.5? He does a 40.3. Took 0.2 of a second off his previous best.
And he did a poor final sector. I say poor, it was only 0.5 slower than his final sector, but there's still more potential in there. There we've got the 4 car. Currently second then. He's kind of snuck up there, Sergei Rybov, because we haven't had that many cars. We've only had 3 cars set representative lap times. But with 12 minutes to go, that is all going to start to change now as they... Oh, very big slide on the exit from Rybov.
Yeah, he just let the car run wide. There's a bit of a rumble strip on the exit of the corner. And if you catch it badly, it just makes the car snap a little bit. But he was moving forward sufficiently that the momentum steered him clear of it. And he's out of turn 15 and on his way to complete another lap. Currently in fourth place. And what's he going to do now? He stays in fourth place.
So...
Oh, sorry. Car stays in second place, but
it's car number 4. That's the confusion, isn't it?
Yeah, but so, I mean, 1.9 seconds slower than Jonathan Hershey, and that is, you know, Hershey's done a very, very impressive job. As we go back to first of the two Ferraris, this is Giuseppe Ciro now in the car,
and he's done his personal best in sectors 1 and 2, and actually they've been pretty decent sectors. This could well take him to within 0.5 of Jonathan Hershey on what is his first outright flying lap, so this could be a pretty impressive lap from Giuseppe Ciro. Out of the final corner he comes. I'm expecting maybe a high 1:40 across the line. The sector beam says 1:40.6, so only 0.3 seconds off. It's battle on for pole.
Yeah, I mean, the first time I've seen somebody put in a challenging lap to match Jonathan Hershey, and we've seen it from Giuseppe Ciro in the Ferrari 458, and then we go back to the car that has the pole position for GT3.
The first race of the weekend,
yeah. Watching just as it came through turn 6 into 7. to get an idea, really, is this car in seriousness going to be a challenge? We've got Harry Procek in the car. Did a good job in Zolder, Procek. We go back now to Kurt Mulligan's in the Audi, and he's continuing again. Personal best in first and second sector. So Mulligan's still in fourth place, having been demoted down there by Giuseppe Ciro in the Ferrari, and the other Ferrari, the Russian Bear Motorsport car, in third place.
Yep, so into the final corner he comes. Cam Mulligan's Dino Lunardi jumps up into fifth place. Hershey has now done a 40.1, but across the line then comes Kurt Mulligan's. Is he going to improve this time around? Yes, jumps up into third place, but the man to watch, Mika Vähämäki, has done a purple sector one, quicker than anyone so far. So this pole position battle is just starting to come to the fore as we continue to watch Giuseppe Ciro.
Yeah, took a big bite out of the curb in turn 13 and trying to really shortcut the apex of the corner. Usually you end up losing time that much, you're that adventurous in the amount of curb you take. So let's see whether this car, currently in second place on a 140.6, can it improve? It does. It improves by a tenth of a second, but now still in second place. But the gap is now down to just under that half second. Here's the car we've got to keep an eye on.
Yes, absolutely. Jonathan Hershey has pitted, so he may still go out, but still got 9 minutes to go in this qualifying session. But Mika Vähämäki has gone quickest of anyone in sector two. He's gone quickest of anyone in sector one. His sector two is maybe 0.3 of a second off where it needs to be. So this could, well, if he can hook up the final sector, stick him on the potential front row of the grid to start off with.
But who's gone quickest?
It's Maximilian Buch who's gone quickest, his teammate. So all of a sudden, Mika Vähämäki goes quickest. So all of a sudden, it's a 1-2 for Mercedes. And Jonathan Hershey will be thinking, right, I better get back out there.
And then these two cars were trading fastest sector times within a sector of each other. As soon as one had gone through the sector, the other went through and improved on that. So the two Mercedes-Benz, the Heiko Gravity Cheroux team, SLS Mercedes-Benz, right on the pace. As we go back now to see what it can do with the Rhino Leapheart Motorsports Lamborghini, Harry Podcheck in the car. Green, personal best. But that's not good enough,
no.
Harry.
He needs to buck his ideas up a little bit. So as he comes into the final corner, he's not too far off the pace, only kind of 0.4 of a second. So I think we're looking at fifth position for Harry Procek at the moment, as he comes across the line now in his Lamborghini and he moves into third place. Mega final sector, a 37.2. So he's managed to find a little bit of pace.
Dino Lunardi has done a stunning time for Audi. He's leapfrogged from the tail of the field up into second place on a 39.892.
Okay, so we have Mika Vähämäki quickest in the Mercedes. Dino Lunardi now second in the Audi. Third is Harry Procek in the Lamborghini. Fourth is Maximilian Buch in the second of the Mercedes. As we watch Dino Lunardi, currently second. He's done a personal best in sector one. Not a good sector two, actually, by all
traffic there as well, so.
Yeah, he's lost half a second in sector two, so this isn't one to get too excited about. Jonathan Hershey still in the pits, and he has now slid down into fifth position. So exactly what the tactic is, we'll wait and see, because he is coming out of the pit lane now, is Jonathan Hershey, as we continue to watch Dino Lunardi in what will be an inconsequential lap. But here he comes then on his challenge for pole position. It's not this lap, but it's going to be the next one where he's going to try and hoist his way. He's only got one more place to go until he's on provisional pole position.
I mean, that lap, in spite of having the Chabert Motorsport Ferrari behind, he lost just over a second. Three-tenths of a second, not over a second. So, in spite of losing time, that was still fundamentally a good lap. Back to Harry Procek, personal best in first sector, normal second sector, Lamborghini currently in third place. Doubtful it's going to make any inroads. They're 0.2 of a second down on the time of the second place car.
He improved his time by the smallest of margins, really, that time around. But he did the personal best final, the best of anyone in the final sector, Harry Procek. So he's definitely got some pace in there as we watch the number one car of Maximilian Buch into the right-hander of turn 13. How's this lap shaping up for him? Again, mild, didn't have a great sector one, I don't think, so this isn't really going to be, well, you can see him back him off to try and find some space now.
Yeah, and I mean, they've dropped from being quickest to start into fourth place. Sister car, Arya Varimaki in provisional pole on a 139.742, followed by Lunardi in the Audi 39.892, and Harry Project in the Lamborghini 39.944. Very, very, 0.2 of a second covering the first three cars.
Very, very close indeed, and we've got 5 minutes of this qualifying session to go, so really it's any choice of five cars, maybe six if Giuseppe Chiro can find a bit of pace. So any one of six cars could take pole position for tomorrow's second race in FIA GT3. Harry Prochek has done an average sector one, his personal best in sector two. If he can marry that up with as good of sector three as he managed last time, he may be able to gain a couple of tenths, which would take him to provisional pole position. Out of the final corner he comes. I'm worried about that first sector. 26.5 isn't particularly strong, but the Rhino's Lightpert Motorsport Lamborghini crosses the line. Any improvement for Harry Prochek?
Yes.
Second place. He edges out Dino Lunardi, but there's still that elusive tenth of a second between him and pole position.
Good run. Didn't get purples anywhere on that lap. Got personal best. Two personal bests and a middling middle sector. As we go back now to the second, this is Jonathan Hershey, who was the pace setter in the opening moments of this qualifying segment, has been pushed all the way down now to fifth place.
Maximilian Buch is going to be coming around to finish his lap before too long, and he has gone purple in sector two. There he is in the Nazmika Vahamaki. Here comes Maximilian Buch then with the orangey red wing mirrors. Is he going to be able to move up? He's currently in fourth position. He takes provisional pole position, 39.662. His teammate comes across the line and goes second, but by 0.08 of a second. It's really close, less than a tenth between those two. Here comes Jonathan Hershey. He has done a personal best in sector one, average sector two. Can he improve? He remains in fifth place. He doesn't improve that time around, but this will be the lap he was building himself up for. That was his first lap out of the pits. Here's Harry Prochek, still in third position. What's his lap times looking like? Not very good, really. He's already
No personal bests, fastest sector times. So this particular lap, not really going to see any improvement from the provisional third place that this car sits in. So he'll go on and try and get it. Let's say it's neat and tidy. 2 minutes, 45 seconds to go. And there we are, the partner Hershey, Jonathan Hershey, stops up at the exit of turn three.
That's a shame for a number of reasons. He's going to lose the back
there
end.
There we go, he lost the back end of the car. Again, look at the mess he's made. Now, I wonder, has he done something to a tyre? Because he's done...
Yeah, because he's parked up, hasn't he?
Yeah, but not just that, he did a lot of damage to the...
It's a strange place to park up, isn't it? You'd have thought you'd maybe find somewhere a little bit further out of the way than that if your car was able to be driven normally. So,
Well, of course, there's no clutch pedal in one of these cars, so if you spin it and the engine stalls, you've got to get away to get the car into neutral before you can fire it back
red
up
flag.
Again.
So the red flags have come out.
Well, slow down.
And the lights came off. He's now turned the lights back on as Jonathan Hershey. So, the session was red flagged with about 1 minute 50 seconds remaining.
But the clock is still counting down.
Yes, so whether that is exactly... So it sounds like they will run out the time at the end of the session. So, therefore... It would look as though it's going to be Maximilian Buch on pole position for the second race tomorrow. Mika Vahamaki in second place. So it's an all Mercedes front row. Harry Prochek in third. Dino Lunardi in fourth. Jonathan Hershey in his Audi in fifth. Cesar Campanico in sixth place. Giuseppe Chiro seventh. He'll be frustrated with that. Eighth place for Stefano Guy, championship leader. Third place around the championship. Sergei Rybov in ninth, and I fear that WRT Audi is struggling a little bit for pace because Kurt Mulliken's
absolutely
tenth.
Quality driver, and yeah. Automatically you'd assume would be capable of dragging the best performance possible out of the Audi, but right now they've got work on that car they need to do. But while the Audi showed great promise with Jonathan Hershey early in the session, it's been the Mercedes first and second, and then the Lamborghini in third place.
And that, I mean, that also, for Kurt Mollekens, it's you know, credit to his teammate, Yves Wirtz, who, you know, is a lot less experienced than Mollekens, but he's not too far off Mollekens' pace. So there is Dominic Baumann congratulating Maximilian Buch for what he thinks will be pole position. Well, no, because look, the clock has now reset itself to 1 minute 58 seconds remaining. So I think we will get this session restarted, but
we have to get the Audi, either get it fired up, or it's got to be picked up on the back of a flatbed.
But that is enough time to get to the end of pit lane.
Yep.
Get around and get one lap in. So
I mean, it's going to be, if you were at the very end of the pit lane and you've got a 60 kilometre speed limit, by the time you get down to the pit lane exit, where you can get on it, you're going
to
be very marginal. In fact, I doubt you would make it round before the flag would come out. So I would be surprised if anybody other than those at the very front end of the pit lane are going to even bother going out.
Yep. So there is the man who is provisionally on pole position and almost probably, the Audi's got going by itself.
I think he just, when he spun it, the engine stalled and he had to go through.
Well, he's new to the car. He was probably going, how do I turn it on again?
I think you're right. I mean, there's a whole lot of fail-safes and, you know, devices on these cars to enable you to start it up. Of course, if the car had spun and it was in gear, for example, how do you start it up? Because there isn't a physical manual clutch in it. It's all done on the paddles behind the steering wheel.
No, that's very true. So, they're congratulating Maximilian Buch, but just hang on a moment, Maximilian, because there may be a chance for someone else to rob him of that pole position if the session restarts. We haven't heard any news of the session restarting here in the commentary box yet. As soon as it does, we will let you know. We believe it is not going to be restarted. We're hearing from the from those in the know, the officials. So, actually, the timing room is just next door. I could probably pop my head through, but there we go then. So Maximilian Buch is, I have had confirmation through the sign language through the window of the commentary box. The session is over.
Yep.
Maximilian Buch on pole position then for tomorrow's second race. Mika Vähämäki will qualify second. Third place for the Lamborghini. It's a very Noah's Ark grid, really, isn't it? Third place for the Lamborghini of Harry Prochet. Great driving from him. Dino Lunardi in fourth place. Jonathan Hershey, his first race in the championship, he will start in fifth. Cesar Campanico, sixth. Then championship leader Giuseppe Ciro starting down in seventh place. Guy in eighth, Rybov ninth, Mollekens tenth. Not a good day for the Ferraris.
Disappointing, surprising. I thought the 458 Ferrari around this racetrack was just a marriage made in heaven, and we've not seen the performance from any of the four drivers on those two Ferrari 458s.
Yep. So there we go then. So Maximilian Buch and Mika Vähämäki, it's going to be domination of the front row from the Mercedes. Let's hear from Maximilian Buch and Dominic Baumann. They're down in the pit lane. Pole position with Hayley Coxon.
Max, congratulations. A front row start for both cars.
Yeah, perfect start in the weekend. I think we improved a lot to be on the top. And I think it's a good step forward for the races tomorrow and should be okay for the moment.
Coming into the weekend, did you feel that the Mercedes was going to be competitive here?
Yeah, the temperatures are not our best, but we tried to be in the pace in the free practice. Tried a bit to train with the older tires, and I didn't expect it that I would be on pole, but better now. So.
Thank you. And Dominic, you had a great pace there as well in your stint. Are you happy with the performance of the Mercedes? Do you think you can convert it into a race win?
Yeah, for sure. I'm really happy. We are both cars. It's the first weekend this year. We are both in the first row. And we didn't expect that we are both in the first row. It's not a real Mercedes track. But I think the team, we both did the best. And that's the good thing today. And yeah, hope for tomorrow we can do the same. That would be perfect.
It seems that every track you've been competitive. so far?
I think the concurrence is not the best one, but it would be great if there would be more cars, and if there are 20 cars, it would be perfect. The tracks are really good. The complete championship is perfect, but not just with 12 cars, it's not the best. But it seems good for us. So,
thank you, guys.
So they will be starting on pole position for the second race of the day tomorrow. And the Heiko Motorsports Gravity Shiru Racing team pretty satisfied, and they are of course the reigning champions, and in the teams championship they're lagging behind AF Corsa just a little bit, 29 points behind in fact. They've only picked up 2 wins this season compared to AF Corsa's 2 as well, but when Heiko haven't won, they've finished a little bit lower down the field than Gravity Shiru's have. So an entertaining pair of qualifying sessions here in Navarra. Second place goes the way of Mika Vähämäki and Max Nielsen, still down there at Heiko.
Mika, well done. Front row start for you tomorrow. Must have felt good fighting for pole with your teammate.
Yeah, of course. It always feels good, but I missed my lap on third lap, so I kind of went a bit wide, so I could have done a bit better, so it will be pole, but this is awesome. Awesome also.
And Max, how did you find racing on this track here in Navarra?
It's okay, a little bit tricky and slow corners, but it's okay.
And do you think you'll be able to deliver in the race tomorrow?
Yeah, I think we can do, for sure.
Thank you.
Scandinavian drivers, always...
Yeah, pretty phlegmatic.
Always giving us...
Minimalist design, minimalist comment.
So, but they will start second on the grid for tomorrow's race. Tomorrow's second race of the day, I should say, because race one in the FIA GT3 European Championship gets underway at 10:15 local time tomorrow morning, and then the second race gets underway at 3:15 local time, with the FIA GT1 World Championship race sandwiched in the middle. Don't forget to tune in for the FIA GT1 qualifying race, which is coming up a little bit later on today here at the Circuit Navarra, and it'll be interesting to see how these cars race around this circuit, really, because it seems that people are saying overtaking is difficult, but we saw last year it can be done.
Yeah, I mean, there are parts of the circuit, particularly when you get to the end of the back straight down into turn 9, it's not easy. We did see last year a couple of brave manoeuvres up into turn 15, and the only thing is, if you make that manoeuvre, you've got to be sure that you can execute it and not overrun the corner, and then, of course, the other car can make the cut back again at the position that it might have just lost. But what to me has been the most interesting thing of this qualifying session has been the pace of the two Heiko Mercedes-Benz, and the fact that those two cars to me look to be much more compliant on the racetrack than we were seeing from the Al Enkel GT1 Mercedes, which were really looking like they're giving the driver a hard time, particularly up at the end of the main straight into turn 2, between turn 2 and turn 3 in particular.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've also got the Audis to watch out for as the course car makes its way around down there at turn 5. They're putting some AstroTurf back on there at turn 2. That'll just get ripped up in a couple of hours' time. I'm not quite sure what's underneath the AstroTurf or what the need is for the AstroTurf.
Ordinarily, they use a form of super glue. And, I mean, it takes a certain length of time for it to cure and go off. What they're trying to do is just do a bandage job up at turn 2 and 3 to put down AstroTurf, or in the case they've been tearing it up, and right now I would imagine there's more torn up AstroTurf than there is remaining, and of course anybody is going to go across that at a slip angle, all it's going to do is just peel it back like as we've seen happen in the previous sessions.
So beautiful Spanish countryside surrounding us here in Navarra, just outside the little town of Los Arcos, 20 minutes south of Pamplona, and it was almost the Raging Bulls on pole position, but in the end, Harry Prochek in his Lamborghini couldn't quite match the two Mercedes. Let's have a little look back. So we saw early on Marcel Wurz trying to get to grips with his Audi in what I believe is only his second ever race weekend, but David Mengsdorf, it was, took the Lamborghini out and put it on pole position for the first race of the weekend. Dominic Baumann was following him all the way, but in the end, it was the Lamborghini that finished ahead. The Ferraris were struggling Michael Lyons struggling a little bit to get the front end in, and also Jerome Demey having a little bit of a spin up there at what is one of the trickiest corners on the circuit.
Yeah, it's a very, very long corner, and it's a kind of question of how you get off the throttle, apply the brakes and turn the steering wheel, plus the downshift, and the combination getting out of sync could be the reason why the back end of the car just drifted. And once it was gone, then there was no real recovery.
So it was David Mengsdorf in that number 11 machine who took pole position. He couldn't take pole position. His teammate couldn't take pole position for the second race. Harry Proschek losing out to Maximilian Buch and Mika Vähämäki. A spin towards the end for Jonathan Hershey ended the session. And that meant that the red flag gave the Mercedes a 1-2. And we'll see you for the racing tomorrow.